time kill us.
Very good afternoon to all the lovers of literature present here. On behalf of Taj Bengal, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all. As you all are aware, and on this afternoon is an initiative of Prabhakirtan Foundation in collaboration with Taj Bengal, and Sri Cement Limited is the presenter of this series. It's my honor and privilege to welcome the guest author of today, Mr. Sandeep Bhushan. Sandeep Bhushan has worked as a television journalist with India's pioneering satellite broadcast news channels, including NDTV and Headlines Today TV, for 20 years. He has written on media for The Economic and Political Weekly, Caravan, Hindu, Wire, Scroll.in, Outlook, and Open. Sandeep has taught media studies at the Center for Cultural Media and Governance, Jama Millia Islamia, and is currently teaching journalism at a private university. He loves mountains and nature. To be in conversation with him, we have another most loved media personality, Ratnottama Sengupta, a natural writer with a keen interest in every aspect of culture. She, since 1978, has worked with leading newspapers like the Indian Express, the Telegraph, and the Times of India, where she was the arts editor till 2015. Currently, she is the managing partner of Winning Management Concept. She is a senior consultant advertising filmmakers at various stages of filmmaking. To take this conversation forward, I would like to welcome them both.
To me, a very dear subject of conversation, the Indian Newsroom. 40 years, and that is the best part of one's life. You know, once you've come out of education and you're making yourself. And those were the years when we, the ladies, we were trying to find our identity. But those were years when Doordarshan also was not quite what it became. So those were really the print years. So I have seen journalism from the bell metal times, when they used to, compositor used to set the news and we used to get galleys to proofread, going on from there to online, where every hour news is being updated. So that's the journey, and it's beyond one's imagination. We didn't know at one point of time. So at that point of time, we didn't know that this could happen. Just a little while ago, I was telling Sandeep that, and for one of the interviews, I was meeting Khushwant Singh, grand old man, another person who changed the concept of journalism many years ago, many times over, in fact. He had once said that whether I go for press conference or whether I go to a boardroom, I pick up all the pens that are there because I write longhand. So from those longhand days to, you know, emojis coming into play. But Sandeep's book made me think of this entire, he says, and someone says that it's actually the history of journalism capsuled between the two covers. What made you think of this book? Because literature, I'm sorry, journalism is literature in a hurry. This book is not written in hurry. It couldn't
happen. No, it's not. In fact, thank you, and thank you, the foundation, for giving me an opportunity to speak to all of you here in Calcutta. Some pretty distinguished people, some students. I'm sure everybody is looking forward to a career and so on. So I mean, to just set it off a little, to just give it a little background. My last job was with what is today the India Today Television, and that's before its name got changed and so on. So I realized that my passion was for reporting. I liked being out in the field, talking to people, visualizing stories, thinking about what can be done. You know, in television reporting, you go out to the camera and mic, and you can see the world change around you. If there are politicians, they'll react differently. If you go without a camera and mic, and they'll be different lot. So I mean, the whole world changes, and I mean, the great thing about reporting is that you're telling a story, which is the good old mandate for journalism for the last several centuries. That I realized was not happening. I think around the cusp was around 2008, 2009, and what finally was my job became was that every day I would land up in the office and they would say, go and collect this bite, go and collect that bite, X wants this bite, Y wants that bite, only this story is going, that story is not going. No, you don't have to give us story ideas. We're just telling you, just go and do the job. That's when I realized, because that's that militated against my basic spirit. I'm not saying I'm a great revealed or some great journalist who's going to make a mark and win Pulitzer Prizes, but I knew that I wanted to do at least tell a story. That's the minimum we all expect, and that wasn't happening anymore. So then I quit in the year 2012, which is about 6 or 7 years now from now, and then that is the time I sort of came out, as I write in the book, it was a bit of a rabbit hole, because the world around me had changed completely. I mean, in terms of the way technology had moved in stealthily, which you never realize if you're part of a newsroom. You know, newsroom, if you're part of a newsroom, they'll say, you know, the camera has changed. You know, beta cam is gone. Now we are using a digital cam. One didn't realize what it meant. Or the fact that, you know, technology is going to determine how we do the video editing. That format has changed. So that's how the technology impinges if you're working in real time and seeing and experiencing it. But once you come out of it, I realize that there are global things happening, and that is impacting even the minutest aspect of journalism, at least in India. And that's when I realized that, you know, continuing with the kind of job that interested me was not my scene. I didn't want to sit in the studio and anchor and faff and scream and shout. That has come to define much of our television in the last maybe close to a decade. And that's when I decided to write this book. And to just take one, add a final point to it, since this book includes a lot of people who are still there, they are stars, they have defined India's satellite television for more than 2 decades now. So I had to be very careful in what I write. I didn't want it to sound like a, you know, as tripe, as some kind of a, you know, some venom I'm going to sort of spit out. So I wanted to do a good research piece, and my background in history, which is a subject I think was dear to me, I think that helped me a lot, because I'd done my MPhil, so I had some idea about how to deal with sources and consult primary stuff.
So talking about reporting, when I started in 78, as you've just heard, we were told, you know, like, getting a byline was a big thing. Okay, so it was mostly anonymous by a news reporter, by our news reporter, and so on. And then if one got a byline, then you had to give everyone a treat in the newsroom. And if one did a particularly good exclusive story, we were told, we used to say, ke, theek hai, byline to de diya, paise bhi de denge kya? So they would say, nahi, chaudha point kar denge. Agli baar ek achhi si story lao, so you'll get a 14-point byline. Now, if you, some of you are students, you might be wondering why 14-point, because 12-point itself was a big thing.
Yeah.
So from there, and reporters, byline hi agar itni badi baat hai, photo to bhuli jaiye. So you never had photographs of any of the reporters. Even the editors, half of them nobody knew. In fact, the story goes, you probably are aware, that once Girilal Jain was in a lift, and the elder son of the then head person in the Times of India group, Ashok Jain's son, Samir Jain, he was in the same lift. And one of them asked the other, so may I ask your name? So that is unthinkable today, and particularly with television, you know, with every anchor becoming a star, you know, the face also became important, even in editorial, right? In print,
editorial page, they started giving bylines. But please, Sandeep, I wanted you to tell us that, you know, did satellite change this? Did, you know, the coming of the private channels change this? Did, it was not just the small screen, it was not just the Indian box.
Yeah.
What is the factor that brought about this change where journalists became stars?
I mean, that is a, I mean, it all depends, but I think in my understanding of television such as it is and what I've written also, I mean, the whole star system was actually put in place with NDTV. NDTV is a place where I worked for close to a decade. And the star system was first started there. Now, as I write in the book, that the star is, in a sense, it reflects a particular sort of, you know, it's a comfort point in television. They straddle the market and they straddle the political class. They are the ones who also get you advertisements, and they are also the ones who have access. Because television in India, in fact, much like print, but much more in television, access is extremely important. No television journalism is possible without access. Because the whole concept of breaking news, of so-called exclusives, which you see, you know, which has run out of all meaning, but which you see all the time, it's only because you have access. Because somebody, some editor, some reporter has a fix on the guy who's putting in news in the 24/7 news hour cycle. And therefore, that access is only possible if there is a star. Early on, reporters had some bit of the access because we were hanging around party offices. We had a lot of good connections with a lot of leaders. But
Roger,
by and by, that became
the credibility, Roger, the faith in the news reporter.
Yeah. So yeah, and by and by, if you are a politician and if I'm an anchor and I'm also the editor of the channel, or maybe somewhere in the top 3-4 in the pecking order, then you see more point in cultivating me than a lowly reporter like, let's say, my friend Vivek, you know, who may not be able to influence the news cycle in a way that an editor can do. An editor can make your story or your mug or your bite play out for, let's say, half a day. A reporter can at maximum say that, you know, yeah, this is a damn good bite, why don't you run it? And, you know, still, that's not the final word. It's the way news cycle functions. So, in that sense, cultivating the editor became much more profitable for whoever was the so-called source or whoever was in the political this thing for a moment at that point. So the star system has come to stay. NDTV set the template, and I think what has happened over the years is that reporting has dried up and everything has become a studio game. The rise of ANI or news agencies, like, I mean, ANI is, it can be explained more clear, you know, communicated more easily if I say it's like the television equivalent of PTI or UNI, which is an agency which gives out news. So if you look at television closely, most of the bites that play out are from news agencies. Reporters are immaterial. So television channels,
even in the small towns, even in the remote areas, are they?
Yes, I mean, I was in Bhopal for about 4-5 years as a reporter, and I remember that I had set up the Bhopal bureau there, and we had a huge network of stringers. This is the day pre-Google days. Actually, this is really the early years of the turn of the millennium, and all this was not there. So we used to depend on them, and I remember that we had some fantastic stories on NDTV on Java, on Kanha and Bandhavgarh and the tigers and, you know, the man-animal conflict kind of. But now it's all, so the ANI is done, it's modeled itself largely on the way PTI has done. They have district level guys, and it's a competition system. I mean, if there are 5 districts, the guy who gives the best news, that guy's feed is taken and supplied to whichever channel is interested, and that guy gets the money. So there's no assured income for anybody, and it all depends on what you're able to get, and in real quick time, and preferably in exclusive. So even the stringership system is gone. So all kinds of human elements are being sort of marginalized. They're made marginal. Technology has made the human element pretty marginal to news operations now. I mean, it's effectively technology.
It's only what comes off the feed.
Yeah, what is there off ANI, what comes from Twitter, what comes from Facebook. Twitter is a major source of news. And
what
this
was in our times, the teleprinter,
yeah,
has become the Twitter.
Yeah.
Talking about the stars, you see, I'm going to now come to a few names. There are two persons who are, in certain sense, the opposite of each other, the way they have been seen on the screen, small screen. Pranay Roy and Arnab Goswami. You know, one, Pranay Roy has changed the way we see elections, but even today, he is unobtrusive. Even when he sits there and is conducting as he did in the last elections, he was quite unobtrusive. And Arnab, he is there, all caps. You know, when he has even guests, they are all there for like punching bags. You know, he needs to talk. I mean, what is this compulsion to be all over? Is it is it a generational change in the anchors in the stars?
Yeah, this is actually a very good and a very complicated question. Then my own take is that Pranay Roy represented a particular moment in television history, of satellite television, when it was coming out of Doordarshan, out of the arms of Doordarshan, which was a state sarkari thing, and here was a guy who was a movie star, good looks, who brought in stories which nobody thought about, the production with A-plus kind of production qualities, but he was still appealing to a much more genteel kind of audience. You know, when I was in Bhopal, I remember that all the regular NDTV viewers were people who were in the government, IAS, IPS, everybody of that sort of people, you know, lot. But I think what's happened is that two, three things have happened. And one of the things is that the viewership has changed. I mean, you know, earlier on, we had a company called AC Nielsen, which used to chart the metrics. And AC Nielsen used to take very small section of people as sample for its viewership figures. And these were mostly weighted in favor of Western India. What has happened ever since BARC, or Broadcast Audience Research Council, has come into being is that they are every year, they're increasing the sample size by 10,000 people, and you know, across age groups. So that is now changing the programmatic content very, very distinctly. Programs, news networks which prided itself on being only English are now bilingual. In NDTV, not a Hindi reporter won't be allowed in the English language 24/7 newsroom. Now you'll see a lot of guys who are reporting BJP, they speak actually Hindi. Mirror now, which is a Times of India group, they've got regular Hindi English. You know, they keep on till the Faye D'Souza comes in the evening. In fact, she also speaks in Hindi.
But
so that is a
isn't incorporation of Hindi also during the Z times? I mean, they consciously, even in paper like Times of India, I don't think Statesman went that way. But Times of India, I mentioned as even in Times of India because it's one of the early British period leftover flavor. And even they started using Desi English and, you know, spoofing.
But in the case of Z, actually it was always a Hindi channel. It never pretended to be a bilingual one. Mm-hmm. In the cases of these English language channels, which like Times Now, NDTV and CNN, IP in the top three initially, they positioned themselves as English language channels. They never had pretensions that we are going to give space to Hindi. Mm-hmm. Hindi was, I was in the newsroom, I reported both Hindi and English, mm-hmm. and there was a clear kind of distinction between the kind of salaries English guys would get, the salaries these guys would get, the kind of perks, everything varied. So there was a distinct class element to this Hindi-English divide in the newsroom, and that extended everywhere, but that has dissolved. But I think this kind of a Arnab Goswami type of a thing is a combination of factors, some of which I've already spoken about. One of the things was the meltdown, which means bureaus were disbanded en masse across new networks. And so what reported in the so what replaced that was studio performance. So performance became the main this thing, since how do you run a channel today? Also, if you read, which I mentioned in my book, even the Republic TV marketing people say that if Arnab leaves, this channel collapses. This whole channel is around Goswami, around one man. So he's appealing to a constituency which did exist when liberalization began in the 1990s. Now we have what our Prime Minister says, a neo middle class, which is, you know, a new class which has come into a market. They are the ones whom FMCG companies want to sell products to. They use news channels to reach out to them, and therefore they are important players. Now they decide what content goes on. I mean, those are important variables. These have not been researched, but these need to be looked at more closely, because I didn't have that kind of resources. But I'm saying that somebody funds it, that kind of a research is needed.
One of the other things that amazes me is how we today take it for granted that the news channels can actually go into the wars and they can show. I mean, of course, we have the television cameras, satellite cameras, and so on and so forth. But the entire, I'll mention three major things in my own time. One was, of course, Kargil. The other was with Kandahar, the skyjacking.
Yeah.
And the third is the World Trade Center hits in New York.
Even the Parliament being those are
So that also, but these are, I mean, major things, you know, I mean, suddenly we see before us. Even the second tower collapsing, the first one I didn't see, but I could actually, because television, worldwide, I mean, it was happening in New York, which is almost, close to half a day away. And I could see, within half a minute, I could see it collapsing. I mean, those kind of thing has happened because of television and because of the satellite channels and so on. But has it sensitized it, us, or has it desensitized us to terrorism, to war, to violence? And this question, I mean, just before I give the floor, it has been on my mind because at around that point, there was a film called Speed, and one of the promotional things they had done was won a contest, and if you were a winner, you were given a button by pressing which you could blast off a bus. So I had asked, that's a prize, you know, violence as a prize. I mean, is that desensitization?
Television is actually, it doesn't go there anymore. I mean, in India, you have to realize that that kind of a violence, I mean, we've had very few which have been televised live. The Bombay attack was the last one. Because, I mean, when I say, even in the case of the Parliament attacks, the only those cameras which were there, they could record, and they also bolted. Because, you know, in fact, ANI lost one camera person who got hit in the head because he was trying to capture some footage. So that has been one major one has been the Mumbai attacks. And I would say that, at that point, there were a lot of interesting questions raised, whether a lot of things that happened, some of them involved giving out information said that was sensitive, some of it said that help the terrorists, plan out real time how they're going to sort of deal with this entire thing. After that, the government came down like a ton of bricks that time to the UPA government, and they laid down certain guidelines. And one of that was, there's going to be no live telecast anymore. That has to be, every television wala has to carry it as deferred live, and you have to write with a certain gap you carry that. You can't carry the footage live, which means that basically you ensure that anything that is a giveaway to the people who are trying to attack or who are trying to harm, it doesn't sort of further their cause and position. And in that sense, it sort of reined in things. In fact, when the Pathankot thing happened, if you remember, one of the issues why they wanted to shut down NDTV India was they claimed that some stuff was shown that gave away the army's position in that cantonment when the ISI-backed guys invaded Pathankot. But actually that turned out to be a hoax, because this government has issues to settle with NDTV, and therefore they are relentlessly sort of attacking it, including arresting Pranoy Roy. Not arresting, in fact detaining him and not allowing him to fly. So that's a separate issue. But you know, that apart, I mean, violence in India is actually, television is no longer about any graphic depiction of anything. It's all about whataboutry. Every single question gets translated into whataboutry. If you oppose Kashmir, some channel will run, is Congress, become a Muslim party? Has it become a Pakistani party? you cannot utter a word now without, you know, there's some what about it not happening. So we are not living anymore in television. In fact, Mark Tully, whom I've quoted, has said that Indian television has actually gone back to radio. There's more of talking and less of visuals. There's no visuals anymore.
Very true.
Because that's a cheaper alternative. It's
absolutely
a very cheap alternative. You just get five guys in studios and all the five guys.
Reality shows.
Yeah.
These reality shows
absolutely
spend on the sets. Mm-hmm. But chats, you don't need to do anything.
Yeah.
And of course, sports coming in a big way.
Yeah. And chats, you can also game the editorial content very easily. If I get five people whom I know what position they have, and I give them a free run to say what they want, or not allow them to speak if I think, or if the position is uncomfortable, I've gamed it. And everyone knows, I mean, you talk to, I mean, the guys which you really talk to and one doesn't hear at all are these guest coordinators. They are the guys who will tell you, and they are the absolutely unknown, anonymous people in television channels, but they will tell you that Barkha wants this kind of people, Rajdeep wants this kind of people, they want young women, they don't want older men and women on channel. We want guys, they're casual, that Pakistani bald guy who every day comes and abuses. You know, he every day issues outrageous statements and you'll see him on one or two channels. But the downside of it is that all kinds of fringe violence has been mainstream on television. Because you do that to the Pakistani guy, you also do the Hindu Jagran Manch chap in Meerut, who's gone and when a Hindu and a Muslim interfaith couple were having some private moments, they just barged into the room and called out the parents and created hell. And that guy was next is sitting in a primetime studio in Delhi. So, you know, this is the kind of thing that's happened. It's hit a low which is, I think people in Bengal perhaps don't even watch that kind of low.
But Sandeep, talking of the opposite point of view being aired, when I came into journalism, one of the first lessons was that a reporter shouldn't have an opinion. The reporter has to listen and report both sides of the story. And today, this morning, Shabana has given a very nice Facebook quote. She has said, if I say it's raining and you say it's not raining,
yeah,
a reporter has to look out of the window and say what he or she sees out there. Okay, so which means you actually go into the reality, you go into investigating. Okay, but today, I don't want to watch a certain channel because I know exactly what point of view they are saying. You don't want to watch another because you know exactly what they want to say. As you said, it will be the opposite. And investigative journalism has gone out of the window. So, I mean, why? I mean, even in something like the recent doctor's strike, we never saw any of the channels taking a camera. And you rightly said that it's talk and no visual.
Yeah.
And in Telegraph, one of the early, I was there, I joined in the first year and I was there for the first 4 years. And one of the highlights I learned in journalism was we used to have what we called insight, where straight away major photographs of even hospitals, we've carried off hospitals, and the photographs tell their own story on the dirt, the rats, the cats and dogs, and you know, the patients, four patients in one bed, they've been shoved together. So why? I mean, like, is there no interest?
There is. See, if you, there is
behind the camera, as we used to say.
Everything is, I mean, in India, I mean, unfortunately or fortunately, everything now, at least if you look at the media space, is sort of determined by politics. Even if you're talking about television, look at print. I mean, a print of Arun Shori and company who led from the front in receiving post-emergency. When he got the Magsaysay Award, I mean, he got it for something, some great work he had done. Now you look at Express, I'm a regular reader, but I don't find any story, maybe an odd story which is RTI based, which has some sense. So there's a general collapse, and I think in the 5-6 years there's been a more severe kind of, in a sense, I won't use the word throttling, but there's something that's happened to the media ecosystem that nobody seems to have had the courage to write and speak about things that matter. I mean, if you do for instance, one of the things that is doing the rounds, and I'm not saying this is the first-hand information I have, but one of the reasons why Dr. Roy got caught in the Mumbai airport and sent back was the fact that they felt that the NDTV's line that they had taken on Kashmir was being used, part of the footage was being used in by the Pakistani television, in the Pakistani social media handle. Now, you can't help that. We use so much, our television channel use so much of stuff that is from across the border. So, I'm saying, when you have a situation where you can't even talk straight about an issue as controversial as Kashmir, then where do you expect investigative journalism? There were big stories that were broken. If anybody cares to, almost complete blasphemy if I speak, but if you look at the issues of caravan, the kind of issues they have touched upon, nobody wants to touch. Jay Amit Shah's case is everybody's, I'm sorry, I hope I'm not offending anybody here. I don't know what the politics are here. But that whole thing in Wire was a big this thing, and nobody knows what happened in that case. It went before the court. So, where do you expect? One of the things that Enram also spoke about when the Bofors thing happened, that when we broke the story, the entire media, that's how stories get traction. The Watergate was broken by two journalists and the whole media sort of got after that story, and then everybody started getting bits and pieces, and then it became the big picture. The president had to sort of step down. In India, that doesn't happen. When the Rafael thing was done by Hindu, nobody followed it up. So then if you don't follow it up, then what happens?
One of the things I would like to ask is, you mentioned Hindu, which still is the owner driven. Indian Express, of course, RNG, when I joined Ramnath Goenka, was the big man there who had defied. Yeah. I came in just after the emergency was lifted and so on and so forth. So he was the big man who had defied, and he's still an icon in journalism.
Okay. Absolutely.
And Times of India, of course, other than being the old lady of Boribandar, it also had, this whole thing, Hindi journalism. I'm not going into the politics, but the Dhanveer Bharti, because of
Times of India.
Poverty, focusing on poverty and writing about poverty in the way, and then also they had these sounds, Times Foundation, these things about eye donation and whole lot of other things they have done to sensitize also. But now that owner-driven factor, the imprint of the owners is gone, and nor are the editors really in a position
That's a thing which even the TRAI reports, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India reports, have also said that political ownership should come down. But unfortunately or fortunately, it's rampant. We've seen what's happening in Bengal. Some of it is, we keep on hearing the Sarda stories in the national media. It's discussed widely. In South, the entire spectrum is captured. All your Andhra Prabha is run by the Telangana Chief Minister.
Yeah.
There's a newspaper being run by DMK. Then there's Jan. This is something which, has to be some regulatory. There's a whole chapter I've written on this.
But the whole regulatory fiction channels also, they were essentially from the same print families. Print.
Some of it was Ratnottama Di, but also the channels also. In India, all the media entrepreneurs, whether it was Pranoy, whether it was Mr. Goyal who started ZTV, they all came from within the womb of Doordarshan. The overarching patronage system spawned by Doordarshan, of which Bhaskar Ghosh has written brilliantly in his book Doordarshan Days, which you guys must read, that gives you a real sense as to how the entire media ecosystem was determined by who ran Mandi House in Delhi.
Yeah.
And so that patronage clan system has dogged television through and through private satellite television channels. And when in 1995 the Supreme Court ruled that airwaves are free and it's a matter of trust and the government should start a regulatory process where it should be impartially governed, no government, starting with the Congress down the line to UF, whatever, whoever has come to power, is not interested in regulatory structure. Because once you have a regulatory structure, licensing would be different. The way you're going to allow, for instance, editorial, this kind of a free-for-all will not happen, where you demonize a community, demonize lower castes, these kinds of things which are rampant and which, the getaway. I mean, these things would not have happened, but unfortunately, all these, including Dr. Roy, who have always voted for self-regulation, which I also think should be done, unfortunately, they're all paying the price for that. Yeah,
but also, at the same time, I mean, it's not just the anchors who've become stars. Television channels have also changed the whole, the template for how we look at someone we want. I mean, take the ads, for example. We were talking yesterday, and I thought that it's interesting that, you know, when we were in college, you know, there were models who would become actors. But by the time television came, private channels came in, the actors were giving out all the messages in on television, on selling all the products and so on and so forth. And in one of the mass comm classes, I was asked, why is Amitabh Bachchan selling Miranda? Mm-hmm. You know, those were the things that were happening. Has that changed the entire way of looking at celebs? I mean, like, even for opinions, we go to celebs, big names, whatever.
I mean, there are two things happening. One is the rise of social media, Twitter. I mean, if you look at Swara Bhaskar, I mean, she's a very brave woman. She takes a very independent position. Or you look at Anurag Kashyap. These people, they come out, they're open, they have taken a political position, and therefore they do matter. I mean, the fact is, at the end of the day, there is, for like it or not, I don't like it, but you have to live with it, that there is a kind of multiplier effect if a celeb comes and states a position or endorses it. I remember when the JNU thing was happening, that's an institution to which I belong. I remember Swara Bhaskar was a former alumnus of JNU. She was there in a number of studios. She came out and spoke. So it does, in a sense, bring in a certain amount of traction, I guess. I mean, star value does work. But star value also, you have to realize that at some points, the stars also start using television to further their. I mean, when, for instance, I remember long years ago when Aamir Khan was launching some movie, I forget which one, he came and sat with Megha Patkar and Jim Jantar Mantar, when he had nothing to do with the Narmada Bachao Andolan. So I'm saying you get used to it, and it's a very tricky position. You see, I don't have, and also celebs bring in money. In a revenue-starved networks where every pie counts, celebs bring in money, they bring in eyeballs, you have movie launches. You know, I unofficially have been told that some of the stars also put in money for certain time, for slots where they pay money and say, okay, I'm coming up with a movie, how I'm willing to part with whatever, 10 lakh, 20 lakhs. I remember NDTV in 2005 or 6 had Bunty and Bubbly in the studio reading out news. Both Abhishek Bachchan and Rani Mukherjee, they were inside. I remember I was there in the newsroom that day. They came in and they sat in NDTV India and read out the news, which I thought was crazy, which even Arnab Goswami hasn't done, which Pranoy allowed. But I'm just saying that, I mean, there's something, obviously, it's a very star-struck. We have a middle class, it's a cultural thing. Television, I mean, movies in India is a cultural thing. When you have songs, you look at Bollywood, you remember Devanand because of the great song that came in his movie. Nobody remembers his movie. So film is a kind of, it's a kind of opium. Hindi film, at least, Hindi speaking, I'm sure in Bengali movies also, it would be a similar kind of exercise. So it's a complicated relationship.
I think it's time to invite questions. I mean, we could have gone on for at least 15 minutes more without boring each other. Don't know about the audience. But if there is any question, taking the discussion, the conversation further. I told Sandeep, we're not going to have an interview, we're going to have an Abda, Kolkata style.
So let's hear from the students. What do you like about, or don't you like about television? What are the things that you think about when you watch television? Do you watch television at all? Or is it social media all the way, you know, mobile phones? Like, I'm teaching media studies and all students are only, there's nobody who watches television in my class. Everyone is on the mobile.
Okay, just two things. Yes, print actually should have gone out when television came. It didn't. It, in fact, reinvented itself. One other thing, television should actually have become also redundant, given that everybody catches news on the mobile. But you were talking about social media. Very briefly, social media gives every one of us a chance to put out our opinion. You know, the newspapers used to have the editorial letter to editor columns. That is Twitter or social media, if you ask me. And a little bigger version of that used to be one lead editorial column, the lead, which as we used to call it, which was an analysis of something. Some of the people still do that, even on social media. But would you say social media is where you would look for news? Does anybody look for news? You do?
I do. I think I can. There are podcasts nowadays where it is not where the advertisers pay, so you got to get to hear opinions and, you know, true news, I feel, because nobody pay, no advertiser paying for it.
But there being no filter, does it also allow color?
Probably, but if you listen to a few of them, you get a good sense
spectrum.
Of what is there. Yeah. Where is in the TV news? Today, at least, I'm not able to trust any.
Yeah, absolutely.
However, things like Ravish Kumar getting a Magsaysay and other news about NDTV being the trustworthy news channel gives you a good feeling that there is at least some body appreciating such things.
And you mentioned that cinema is a culture in India in particular, cricket and cinema, the two gods. But television has been giving us the content of so many of our friends of late. You know, I mean, like, even this morning, yesterday, Butler House, something about Butler House, and there was one about Mumbai Hotel, we're sitting in Taj, so Mumbai Hotel, then there's No One Kills Jessica, there's, this year, Uri.
Yeah.
Uri got the National Award, the best film. So, television is dictating, it has changed. Even mainstream in the cinema, which
I
used
to
be born
survive,
means that.
They need to survive the kind of competition they have. With so much of, I think there's a lot of fake news as well, which is causing confusion.
So cinema is taking its cue from television and becoming bigger and glossier, would you say that?
I mean,
or becoming more true to life? What would you say? Anybody, Manjina?
No, actually, I don't know about
Manjula's husband is a filmmaker, so this, and she is a journalist, so this is particularly relevant to her.
See, in a way, documentary filmmaking is kind of not that popular, but it is trying to now incorporate some documentary features into feature films. You know, the format is becoming now, a lot of it is like fact-based.
Yeah, at one point of time, yes. We always thought of biopics as something Films Division did. Mm-hmm. But now biopics are the biggest sellers.
No, one of the things I think television does is that it sort of makes an issue known to public. Even if you're making a movie on, let's say, Jessica, she's already there in the mind space. And, you know, therefore you create a character, you make a movie out of that, and there's already some kind of a memory capital, if you can call that sort of an expression, already there, so people can either the recall value immediately. I guess, you know, when Nanavati, that movie initially got made on Nanavati earlier, I think nobody, perhaps very few people knew.
Ye raaste hai pyaar
ke. Haan, ye raaste hai pyaar ke. Sunil Dutt and Leela Naidu. So, I mean, that time very few people, maybe in Mumbai they must have known, or maybe in some of the metro cities, but you know, now Jessica became so big because of the traction television gave it that, I guess, you know, similarly, this one, I think, on this Budhao, this girl, Dalit women, girls who committed suicide, this rich movie which has come
article.
Out. Article. Yeah, that is also, so these are things that they are, in a sense, non-fiction is giving the grist to stuff which can be fictionalized and made into a better sort of more powerful representational stuff.
When Peeply Live
was the drought.
Television and drought.
Absolutely. But why don't you tell us a little bit more about the dependency on commercials? How does that impact?
See, in India, if you realize that the overall picture is that the television revenue model is more subscriber dependent, is more advertising dependent than subscriber.
But that's true for, even more true for print. I mean, that 2 rupee or 1 rupee now, I think. I mean, this is one thing that has been costing less and less.
4 rupees,
whatever. I mean, like, this is one commodity that kept costing less and less. Even the newsprint, when we sell in Raddi, you know, we get some money back. Mm-hmm. But bringing out that newspaper costs multiple times the amount we pay to buy it. So,
I mean, it's a relative thing. I mean, television production costs even more. If you send me as a reporter to do a story, let's say to Calcutta from Delhi, I fly down, I stay in at least a 4-star hotel. You bear all the expenses, you send a cameraman. And I mean, though the cameraman may belong to my organization I work, but you have to compute it. If you want to compute in term monetary terms, you pay that cameraman for a shift or 2 shifts or 3 shifts if it's a 3-day. So I mean, it's, you know, the film, the whole business. So the thing is that it is very expensive, and you know, you and for all that you shoot, what you get is a 2-minute story, often maybe a 5-minute story. So that is still much more than what you spend in taking out one single newspaper. And therefore, the economics business of revenue thing of television is a very dicey thing. In the US and all the bigger countries, the cable system is so evolved, you get all the triple play from the from your cable distribution business only, that you don't need to, there are the HBOs and stuff all on cable. But in India, that it's a very infant stage. And now, of course, the ratio between subscriber and advertising is getting better. But one of the reasons why India's television went bust in post meltdown 2008 was precisely this, that it was all ad dependent. And once it happened during demonetization, the same thing happened. The television market went into a tizzy because there was no money and advertisers won't pay. Again, they are saying with this slowdown happening in the economy, the first thing the advertisers are going to cut is the advertising money. Once that happens, this industry starts suffering. But that is to an extent being addressed by this digitization, which maps the more accurately the number of consumers or the number of viewers who are viewing a channel or in a particular time band.
But just to provoke you, my experience with television reporters, early years, you know, when I'm just turn of century, when Lagan and Gadar and all these films were coming out and it was big, and so people would come for my view on these films. They were actually game changers. Dil Chahta Hai. They would hold the camera, hold the mic, and the camera was of course there. And I would be asked to speak, give my opinion. I would speak first in maybe 2 or 3 minutes because I've learned on radio itself to be very brief. When it was aired, it was 10 seconds. And the rest of what I had said would be passed off as wisdom of the reporter. What yeah. do you say to that?
Oh yeah, that is some, that's a complaint. That kind of exclusive space is only reserved for netas. You won't get it.
I'm not a neta.
So if Mamata Banerjee tomorrow makes a comment, I mean, surely it will be a 5-minute bite if it's a good attacking bite as she is capable of giving. You can run several bulletins, you can run a whole talk show the half of a day if she says something like that. If that time an artist is not going to get or a journalist will not get, but surely a politician will get. And we have seen what happened with elections. Yeah? Modi's yeah. speeches are just played ad nauseum through the day. So.
And I know the time is over, but you know, like Lalu used to be the reporter's delight. Who's your delight now?
Well, I think I've got a perverse kind of this thing, but I think Mani Shankar Iyer is good. He provokes, he attacks, yeah. he's no holds barred. I mean, you need people who are not scared anymore of the big leader. No? You need people to talk, but I think unfortunately, even Chidambaram is very good. Now I suddenly have discovered him after he's not in power.
But what about
Subramanian Swami?
He's a loose cannon. He can just go and swing, as they say, any which way. So.
Actually, time is not
yeah.
up. I mean,
if
anybody has,
here,
yeah. I have
any
questions.
Please,
inviting.
Ask.
I mean, please make.
I want some of the young students to ask me yeah, something.
Spice up the conversation.
At least once.
Yeah. Why don't you give your name and introduce? Sorry, I should have asked you as well.
Well, I'm Sujata.
and I'm a homemaker.
Oh.
Lovely. Wonderful.
I'm Navamita.
Navamita.
I'm a first year psychology student from the Red. You brought up social media, so do you believe that the concept of TED Talks, do you think that they're an improvement to removing fake news from the entire media industry?
TED Talks?
Yes.
But TED Talks is some kind of a celebrity talk, isn't it?
It's not just celebrity talks. It's actually a
motivational or whatever.
Motivational.
I mean, the catchword of somebody.
Educational.
I'm sorry, I'm not very up on set. But I don't know, how does that tie with fake news?
Okay, so TED Talks, they're like a variety of things. There can be things like, obviously most people would know the TED Talk that Shahrukh Khan gave, but I'm not speaking from that perspective. I'm talking about information. Like, there was one TED Talk which spoke about water preservation that was happening in Costa Rica. Things like that, they actually provide news.
So I get the drift, but I think, you know, fake news is not something that can be tackled through TED Talks. If that's, I think you get a sense of what, because I know at least one, some of the journalist friends of mine have given TED Talks. That's why I asked if it's only a celebrity affair, and they're celebrities of sorts. I mean, they're not big guys, but they're celebrities nevertheless. But I think fake news is a much bigger industry. It's something which requires a much deeper sense, but I'll just give you bullet points about it. One is that in countries like India and Russia, fake news also has a huge fix in the government of the day, in the ruling party of the day. So there's a lot of it coming from that side. Fake news, I mean, you have a whole lot of development in information technology, bots and this and that, you know, that kind of thing keeps on happening. Third, I think that this is a very important thing from a standpoint of a news organization, is that there are no filters in the editorial. It's very important if you read, for instance, of the British Broadcasting Corporation, they have something called a user-generated content cell. So it's a global network, so they keep on getting feeds and visuals from across the world. And there is, that gets processed by a particular desk, a certain number of dedicated people who know exactly how to bust fake news. You know, all that reverse search, Google reverse image search and all that kind of thing, which alt news is doing now. So it's important that to purvey fake, to ensure that fake news doesn't come in the mainstream news. I mean, that's the first thing that needs to be done in India, but it's not been done at all. I know, for instance, none of the news channels do have this kind of a thing. I don't know if it's there in print. And this is a very specialized job, as this alt news person, gentleman Pratik Sinha, keeps on talking about, that there are various ways to cross-check and double-check. So it's a complicated thing. I have no idea if it can be stopped completely. Because in the case of, as we've seen in the case of the crisis in American presidency, one of the things has been planting of news by the Russian agencies. Yes. And it's not just in India. Cambridge Analytica and Putin, in fact, they have made it close to find, they have these factories, fake news factories, literally, which are there in the suburbs, and they say similar things are there in our country too.
World War II.
So it's also a weapon of war. It's a war of in the kind of ideological space. Social media is leveraged to create, push a particular political view.
In fact, during the Bangladesh war, at the end of it, you know, there was a news, I mean, it came out in the newspapers, and those were not when you could just plant a photograph and write something.
Radio played a very big role.
General Niazi was reported to be dead when he was born.
Also, there's a Bengali
and then,
journalist.
So there used to be, there has been, well, whether that was a fake news or misreported, you know, communication or whatever. But it does affect the way the military would react, the way the army would react or whatever.
Staying with fake news, I think it also is important to remember that we have cases where President of the United States also speaks fake news. We also have fake news coming out from our own Prime Minister. There are a number of cases. It's just that our media doesn't document it. They have literally documented it, 3,000 or 5,000, something like that. Here you have fake news where he went to the Prime Minister with an election speech in Bihar and he said something about Takshila being somewhere around. And there have been N number of ones. I mean, literally they've been busted so many times, but it's not an organized kind of busting. The pushback that American media is giving to the US President does not exist in our country. So we don't get to hear less about it. And ministers have been doing it. When the JNU British, thing happened, British, there was a union minister involved in it.
British used to be very irreverential. They still are far more. We kind of look upon our people, and our political leaders get away by saying, oh, I was misreported. Oh, it was the journalist who has misquoted.
Yeah.
Will our media...
Sorry. Yeah?
You're talking about... So
your name, please?
Prachuriara, and I'm from Political Science Department from Loretta College.
Prachuriya. Okay, Prachuriya. Okay, good.
So
Aishwarya Prachuriya.
It's actually Prachurjo in Bengali. So we're talking about fake news and social media, but most of the news channels and most of the newspapers have their own verified Facebook pages which display the news. So how can it be like when a verified Facebook page of the news channel gives a news, it won't be a fake news? And children, I mean the teenagers like us, are now more dependent on phones than the television.
Maybe actual... place from which the online news has feed has.
So what's the question I didn't catch?
I just see it like in the terms of fake news.
See, online also it is filtered.
Mm-hmm.
So is it fake or is it manufactured or?
As in, can it be fake if it's on a verified platform?
On Facebook, I think she wants to say if it's Facebook, is it verified?
It's like,
I mean, it could be verified is not the issue. The point is, does the news, is it based in facts? Is it, I mean,
if
I mean,
your intention is to put out a fake news, you're going to mask it like a real news,
the
right?
And the thing is that
and
on
then
balance,
you can go back on and say that, you know.
On balance, print, I've not come across very many. I mean, in fact, I don't know if there are any fake news in print. Once Hindu reported, I think several years ago, what an Iranian gas pipeline story which ran in headlines, which was turned out to be wrong, and then they retracted exactly in that same headline in the first page that our report was wrong.
You know, there's a lovely short story in Bengali which I read many years ago. Yeah.
You think the social media has given a real boost to the fake news? Now, for example, recently the Bihar floods, there was a picture all over in the social media. There's a young child who's just on the, in the water, nobody's...
Yeah.
And I also tweeted that photo. Then I got a call from very senior politician from Bihar that, you know, this is all because somebody wants to blame Nitish Kumar government.
No.
This picture is not from Bihar at all.
Yeah.
This picture is from some other country of some other time.
Yes.
And then they also told me that there's a medium of verifying those pictures you send to some particular site or something.
Yeah.
So in the social media, the picture is not without place on the photographer. 90% of the time they are fake or something.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes, so there was one photograph which went around primarily in WhatsApp. It was about one school teacher beating these little kids, blue and grey and God knows what other colour. And then they said this is from a school in Bihar. And then eventually it was verified that this was not India at all. But in Bihar it was some place in Africa. I'm sorry, even that sounds very biased and prejudiced. But this was some place in Africa. And merrily it went around saying, and the thing with WhatsApp, you know, is even worse, much worse, because, you know, I mean, like it's being privately circulated.
Yeah.
So you have a kind of trust about the person
she
it has come
question.
From. Yes, please, your name.
I just spoke, never mind.
Right, Navamita.
No, what you just said about WhatsApp, last time that there was this message circulated that WhatsApp will now be charging money according to the government.
And that also comes periodically.
Yes. No, but the last time it came, I believe, beginning of this month or the previous month, someone actually then looked it up and then they posted an article saying that nothing has been released by the government, and then that was circulated. So actually they fought back against the fake news. So in a way, social media is helping to fight it, right?
Really? I hope so.
See, I mean, one of the things, one point which I want to make is that, see, fake news could be, I mean, technology itself does nothing. Yeah, it's the context which on the human agency which becomes important. So, like Sandeep just said that, you know, at a certain point this happens. So there's a certain agenda being, so at a particular moment, in the life of a story or a particular development, that thing is injected to create a certain mood. And that is now, I mean, it's happened since, if you remember, several years ago, there were Northeasterners were targeted in Bangalore, and as it turned out, there were that some Buddhist was getting bashed in China or something, which had been posted, and that created a huge, it was a riot situation, and they fled in droves. But I think that the thing that one of the crisis in India is also that there's a crisis of knowledge. These things, they just get reported as news, as sensational things, and there's no follow-up. When the last lynching in Jharkhand happened, it was very interesting because some of the Express did a half pager on it, and they profiled each of those people who were part of that lynching, and they were very clearly unemployed, frustrated people. There's a certain sociology to it. I mean, all of it was not clear, but I mean, those things need to be reported. How does WhatsApp, for instance, impact tribal communities in Jharkhand and all, where so much of lynching is happening? Nobody knows why there's rampant lynching across Jharkhand is the highest. So these are kind of, newspapers don't follow it up, television, to forget it, it's incapable of doing it. And there is no educational kind of, there's no trust, there's nothing, no knowledge generation body, which you can go back, figure out why it's happening, that, you know, since all these communities in the hinterland, suddenly WhatsApp has become a major agent provocateur, and people are getting lynched, cattle lifting, this and that, outsider, child lifter. All, I mean, these things, one, I remember Vivek would bear me out, and we'd read it in subaltern studies in history books, yeah, that, you know, how at certain moments, crisis points, you know, rumors would circulate and things would flare up. So this is akin to something like that in independent India. So I don't know why it's happening, but it needs to be these.
No, but there's one thing. I believe now with AI, these can be filtered. And I believe WhatsApp, the point that she was making, it's not that social media is having a free run. They are going to try to do this. Otherwise, they will also lose credibility. If you know that every second is going to be a fake news, then you also stop looking up, you know. So, and AI has that potentiality. I think they're working on, you know, the number of times internally. If a thing is going forward, then they will probably, certain things are flagged and they will do something about it. AI has got huge potentiality for this also. They will definitely do it.
So WhatsApp actually was tabloid, but we have quite a few hands now.
Just one thing. So in this current scenario with fake news and television channels having political colors, like you said, where does the layperson turn to for genuine news? I still read the paper every day, but I know my son doesn't. He's onto either social media, okay, occasionally the television. But they'll be just, you know, it's a generation of instant gratification. Whatever they see, they just believe and it sinks in. So
Sandeep will speak and then I.
No, I just briefly, I think that's a very tough question. I don't know where do you get good, I mean, authentic or facts.
Excuse me. I like a true Bengali, I watch DD1 Bengali. Mm-hmm. And I find it's without histrionics. And there's no debate like that. So I follow that.
So I my thing is, 10 minutes of this, 10 minutes of that, 10 minutes of the other.
Yes.
You take in all of them.
That's it.
Sorry, you were also. Sorry, I didn't get your name.
I'm Esha. Esha Dutt.
Esha, hi.
I'm Atri. I'm from History Department of Loreto. So I was talking about fake news, but the thing about WhatsApp, now if we look closely, there are advertisements on television as well which are telling about the fake news on WhatsApp, and they're asking us not to forward it. So there is a method by which we can, you know, curb this spreading of the fake news. And as they were talking about, we are teenagers, and we also do not have the time to go and watch news every day on the television. That is why we have apps on our phone regarding those particular, like India TV app. I follow India TV app because I might not have the time to go back home and watch the television every day or check on the news, but I constantly get those notifications that this is happening. So that's one way to follow up, probably.
Yeah, but once again, that's only one side of the story, right? And also, I'm talking about Facebook and WhatsApp, which seems to be giving more and more of the news to the next generation. Even there, you know, every few minutes, ads propping up, read this, allow me to send in more notification.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't you find that very... irritating. You know, somebody,
they get their money and then
they get their money, yes, but what about my time?
So you have to say,
yeah, I mean, they're constantly impinging on my time. No? That doesn't irritate any of you?
There's a solution to that as well. You have to, you know, buy the premium part of the app, the beta part of the app, and then you don't get any advertisements. But the question is that everyone will not be willing to pay that a particular amount.
Yeah,
it's like 70 or 90 bucks or 100 bucks. Everyone's not willing to pay that. They're just like, we are going to skip the advertisement at that point of time.
And I'm also curious, how much of megabyte or how much of gigabyte, how much do you have? I mean, how much data can you actually hold? Because all of you
know all that.
Constantly
you
have
to know that.
Actually, this is an issue which is, at the moment, I think even if you look at some of the Western stuff, literature that's available, I mean, the collapse of the news dissemination, early on there was a what has been called a vertical model of news dissemination, in the sense there was a news organization which would purvey news and people would sort of buy into it. But that
what was in print was sacrosanct.
Yeah.
Khabare kaguje beriyeche. How can you not believe it?
No, but another thing, observation I've made, I want to make is that information and news. So it's all become about information now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I will not look up the weather channel in the, you know, the paper. Somebody informs me there and then through WhatsApp.
So information, all information is also news now.
No, I'm saying it is, but then we are not relying on television and newspaper for
the
information
no longer
anymore.
In India, nobody relies on TV for any information.
Anymore, but actually news was information was part of news.
Yeah.
So that part has gone totally, and now information you are getting through social media.
In fact, I would safely say that there is no one particular, even if you look at social media, to look at news or information of the kind that you're looking for, you should always have 2-3 portals, at least good portals,
yes,
to, you know, make a to and fro check. You know, for instance, if you look at, I'm talking about global ones, if you look at New York Times, also look at Guardian. If you look at Indian Express, also look at HD
BBC.
And BBC, of course, is, I think the best, it's perhaps the most the most credible media institution in the world, but that's another, I mean, they function totally differently, so we can leave that safely out of the picture. But otherwise, I think it always makes sense ki aap do teen, you know, you go through 2-3 portals, 2-3 types of newspapers, Hindu, and then you make up your mind. Yeah, because they, even the menu, the way they select news will vary. And where they place it will vary, because that's also a hot potato issue, which cover would get some first page, which gets the maximum sort of play and so on.
Okay, so before I wind up, there was, and this I read 50 years, half a century ago, so there was this Bengali story about one of these little newspapers which wasn't selling. So they put their heads together, and the next morning someone's selling the paper, you're reading out the headlines, "Ke Gandhi is going to swim in Hedua." So and so leader is going to fly on this aircraft, and so on and so forth and so on and so forth. So then everybody's flabbergasted. It's selling like how? I mean, what? Gandhi going to swim in Hedua and so and so flying? Kya hua? Everybody's buying the paper. They've run out of the edition. They're printing more. But how do they cope with it? Next day, they say, "Eta shajarir moto. Gandhi is going to give a speech at so and so place, and so and so is going to swim in Hedua." The names got mixed up. So that's what's happening quite often. Let's enjoy.
Thank you. Closing session. Now I would want to invite Mr. Ashok Dhar, prominent author, to come and give away mementos to our speakers here.
I am Ashok Dhar. I am not a prominent author, but I am a one-book author. My book, Kashmir as I See It, From Within and Afar. I don't know how many of you have heard about it, but it has a 5-star rating on Amazon. And it's a book which has been reviewed by Hindu, by Statesman, by New Indian Express, by the Daily Excelsior by Greater Kashmir. It was released here in May.
This year,
by Justice Apatosh Mukherjee, by Mr. Jairam Ramesh in Delhi, on June 4th. And in Kashmir, where actually I come from, it was released on July 6th.
Mm.
And you mentioned about fake news. Because of my passion for Kashmir, I keep tracking. Day before yesterday, I'm sure all of you youngsters must have seen a WhatsApp. It was a video clip of 2 minutes. In park-occupied Kashmir, people are saying, we want to get out of Pakistan. So looking at my iPhone, I couldn't believe myself. So I just looked at it on my laptop. I still wasn't happy, so I went to the big computer screen and I started seeing frame by frame. And I found signages of Baramulla Cooperative Bank, signages of fungicides and pesticides by Rallis India, Tata.
Mm-hmm.
And it's doing the rounds. And I got that from at least 7 persons on my WhatsApp.
Oh, yeah.
So which means how fake news and fake alternatives are actually. And lastly, I am telling everybody I am not in station. Since the day this thing happened in Parliament, I have reporters approaching me, I have anchors approaching me, and I politely say I'm not available. This is my request to all you budding youngsters. I expect if you want to talk to me, you should read my book, or you should read any book on Kashmir. But if you want me to give a soundbite on a topic for which I spent 6 years to research, and you expect to get some big story out of it.
Masala.
I'm sorry, there are people who still spend their lifetime in making a good product, in researching a good story, and you will start realizing you need to change your objective, youngsters, as to who is your icon. And still there are good icons. She named Sainath, he named some others. Hostela, Arun Shori of print. So you need to see if you're starting a career in journalism, what would that be? Thank you very much. Have a good career.
Thank you.
So I was about to ask you, are you for or dar?
Ma'am.
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't know, somebody political science, they would know he was the former dean of Kolkata University. This was his first question. So he said, now everybody in Kolkata knows you are not a Kashmiri dhor, you are a dhar. But I am married to a girl who is a Kashmiri, born and brought up in Kolkata. So that way I have a strong connect with the city. But I don't get invitations for Jamai Shishti. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank
you.
Sir.
No, your book is an insider's account, so I'll definitely be reading it with great interest.
Hopefully,
sure.
Hopefully, it has shed some light on the kind of madness we live through.